Lord. Let's celebrate this morning, this Father Jonathan, and this is the 8th Sunday in ordinary time. Where we begin this morning, this holy God, we praise your name. Please stand for you.
Personnel for going to 60,000 of them going to Ukraine. Is it to there to take care of his soldiers? He's already accused Ukraine of developing a dirty bomb, and he has activated his nuclear deterrent force, which includes nuclear weapons. So we need a prayer for world peace. And so I would say a prayer as I served in Ukraine, in Ukrainian. And I'll say it in English. Господи Боже, відвести святі єдине, те сама святість. Стану перед тобою, що перенудешся, знаю, що я людина грішна. І через свою віру я піддалася від тебе. До цього часу готов жити на власне Росу, у світ спосю і херувався, еге у ізон, вікеда уюче, тобою любов. Сьогодні хочу це зробити, дякую тобі, другий Боже, за благодать, усвідомлення, що там право на вою стати твоєю дитиною, буде прославлений Господи Боже, да Твою безмішно, милосердно любов. Як Те об'ював у Твоєму Сину, моєму Спасителю Ісуса Христа. Прошу Тебе, Богу Святий, Герой моєю молитвою, наповни мене Твою силою, що я відстояв у святому рішенні навернутися, освітлюй мене Твоїм світом, що я унакав река і сильняки поставлені, як буду до нього. Єдиний Боже, я дякую тобі, що ти прокликав мене до себе. До, о Боже, мене відступився від доброго і замилився мене і живетний спокусти і спокус. Амінь. God, Creator and Father of all people, you call yourself to all nations of the world. Enlighten them, awaken in them a sincere desire for understanding and unity. Help them to forgive one another for the evil they have done, and continue to do their due to their neighbors. Help them to cooperate in peace, respecting the rights of everyone according to your will. Cleanse their hearts of all resentment and hatred. Save all nations from pride, selfishness, and ethnic hatred. May all the nations realize their duty to care for peace and absolutely resolutely embark on the path of unity, cooperating with each other with love. Bless God, those who dedicate themselves to the great work of peace. May your holy name always be blessed, and may your kingdom of justice, peace, and harmony come into our souls and our lands. Amen.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves for this sacred mystery. You were sent to heal the contrite heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your very glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone, O Holy One, you alone of the world, you alone of the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that the course of our world may be directed by your peaceful rule, and that your church may rejoice untroubled in her devotion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
The first reading is taken from the book of Sirach. When a sieve is shaken, the husk appears. So do one's faults when one speaks. As a test of what the potter holds is in the furnace, so in tribulation is the test of the just. The fruit of the tree shows the care it has been given. So too does one's speech disclose the bent of one's mind. Praise no one before he speaks, for it is and that people are tested. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsorial Psalm. Lord, it is good to give thanks to you.
Lord, it is good to give thanks to you.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, Most High, to proclaim your kindness at dawn and your faithfulness throughout the night.
Lord, it is good to give thanks to you.
The just one shall flourish like the palm tree, like the cedar of Lebanon shall be well. They that are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
The Lord is good to give thanks to you.
They shall bear fruit even in old age, vigorous and sturdy shall they be, declaring how just is the Lord, my rock in whom there is no wrong.
Lord, is good to give thanks to you.
Second reading is taken from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, and this which is corruptible clothes itself in incorruptibility, and this which is mortal clothes itself in immortality, then the word that is written shall come about. Death is followed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be firm, steadfast, always fully devoted to the works of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But do not perceive the wooden beam in your own. How can you say to your brother, "Brother, let me remove that splinter in your eye," when you do not even notice the wooden beam in your own eye? You hypocrite. Remove the wooden beam from your eye first, then you will see clearly to remove the splinter in your brother's eye. A good tree does not bear rotten fruit. Nor does a rotten tree bear good fruit. For every tree is known by its fruit. For people do not pick figs from thorn bushes, nor do they gather grapes from brambles. A good person, out of the store of goodness in his heart, produces good. But an evil person, out of a store of evil, produces evil. For from the fullness of the heart, the mouth speaks. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, our Lord Jesus Christ.
I have to apologize. You know, sometimes I'm inefficient. I forgot to put up the universal prayers for the general intercessions. Now, I can fake it.
Okay.
But I have to send them to Chapel 02 in Baltimore, so I was late doing that. So I'm going to give somebody the job of reminding me. I'm just kidding. And I spent a lot of time this week, you know, doing things for Ukrainians. I work with people being registered in the embassy, so if there's an evacuation of American citizens, the embassy will know where they are. They haven't evacuated them yet because they just told them to go to Western Ukraine. And through the Red Cross, I've been shipping money for humanitarian aid in Poland and in Ukraine. So far, I think it's close to 100,000 have fled into Poland. They expect 1 million refugees. So, you know, I guess we're all cursed. We, you know, the Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times. Well, we're living an interesting time. Just pray that it's not the end of times. Now, in many ways, Nicholas Green was an ordinary 7-year-old boy. But he became a source of life for 7 people and a beacon of inspiration for the world. Nicholas was born on New Year's Eve, 1986. A new bundle of joy to greet the new year, but not the first one born, so he didn't get all those presents. Along with his baby sister, Eleanor, and his parents, he enjoyed life and all the fun associated with being a child. I feel so sorry for the parents who, you put so much pressure on their children at a young age that they don't enjoy being a child. I remember this one mother sitting next to me in a swim match, and she was saying, well, I hope it ends in time because he's got his violin fallen. I said, but he was late getting here. So they moved him into a different, he had the after school club all in one day. Too much. Now, with the help of his mother Maggie, he had read all 7 books of C.S. Lewis's epic, The Chronicles of Narnia. He loved to role play and considered himself a perfect St. George, pointing out to his parents that he was half English. However, his parents would often say he fit the model of St. George more because he wanted to do what was right. You know, you see him slaying a dragon as slaying evil, not a literal dragon. When Nicholas was 7 years old, his family took a vacation in Europe. Among many places they visited was the beautiful Swiss Alps, where a family photograph captures Nicholas in front of the fabled Matterhorn. 4 days later, the family was in Italy, sightseeing like so many other American tourists. The date was September 29th, 1994. As Nicholas's father was driving a small rental car, a band of robbers approached in a daring robbery attempt. In the process, Nicholas was shot in the head. He was rushed to the hospital, and after a short amount of time, the doctors told his parents that the boy could not survive. He remained in a coma for 2 days, but the doctors told his parents that Nicholas was brain dead. Although the shock and trauma of the recent day's events could not be calculated, Nicholas's parents asked that their son's vital organs be transplanted into needy individuals. At that time, a donor, an organ donor, was a rare event in Italy. Thus, Nicholas's heart, liver, kidneys, pancreas, and corneas were used to bring new life to 7 Italians, including several children who were near death. The resulting dramatic increase in organ donations in Italy has now been called the Nicholas effect. In a very real way, Nicholas Green brought new life to several people, but in a broader effect of his life and decision of his parents to share that life with others might be incalculable. And organ transplants are normal there. People donating their organs are kind of normal. The story of Nicholas and his ability to give life in multiple ways to several people is inspiring. I hope all of us are organ donors. And you say, you know, I don't have any organs fit to give. Bet you do. One of the big organs that you don't really think of as an organ is your skin, which can be transplanted to people with birds, which is far better than sharks. The selfless act of grieving parents who had lost their son was a true act of charity and love. More directly, their decision to utilize Nicholas to assist others shows how new life can come in the midst of death and darkness. Thus, this heartwarming story serves as an excellent illustration of St. Paul's message to the Corinthians in today's reading, that Christ is the one who conquers death and brings new life. We can be confident that Jesus will bring new life to us. We in turn must do what we can in our limited and finite ways to bring new life to others. In today's lesson, Paul continues the basic resurrection theme that he has expressed throughout the whole of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We first heard the resurrection of Christ. We taught that Jesus' death and resurrection was a supreme sacrifice of love for us. As Christ so sacrificed for us, so we must be willing to sacrifice ourselves, our material possessions, personal needs, and opportunities for the betterment of all. In this way, we build the kingdom of God in our world. We are challenged to see that new life in Jesus can give us and how we must adequately and properly prepare for this great event. The resumes for life today and for eternal life tomorrow are very difficult. We must spend as much time, if not more, on the latter to find God at the
end of our days. Today, Paul concludes his message of new life by saying Jesus is the one who brings victory over death, transforming the perishable into the imperishable, mortal into immortal. As St. Paul says, God gives us victory through Jesus Christ. I was watching a video from Ukraine, and there was a man holding a sign in Ukrainian and in English, and it said, so I wanted to get out to the media, "Victory is ours in Jesus Christ." Paul speaks of the new reality we will find at the resurrection of the dead. At the sound of God's command, the dead will arise. Nicholas gave new life to so many. Christ will transform. Christ's transformation is that the mortal and perishable in us will turn into the immortality of God. Wouldn't it be nice to have a body that had no more aches and pains? I just saw a video of a woman who took of her granddaughter is before the age of words, and so she was going to pick up around, picking up her toys, and she bent over and go to the next slide. I wonder where she learned that one from. So we will have a glorified body, no more aches and pains, and we'll all be good looking, which means I'm going to have cosmetic surgery in heaven. Sin and death will no longer have power over us. Paul concludes by saying that the people must be steadfast in the Lord. If we remain faithful to God's command, our labor will not be in vain. Rather, to the contrary, we will move forward in our common efforts to build God's kingdom in our world, transforming our hopeless situations into ones that find and generate life. It's not always easy, but there's ample evidence that such events have happened numerous times. Nicholas' stories are rather dramatic in that through death he brought victory to so many. He made the impossible possible. History presents us with numerous examples of life and victory springing from the clutches of defeat and death. In the history of warfare, this is certainly true. How was it in 480 BCE that the vastly inferior force of some 300 Spartans and about 1,000 other allies was able to hold off the entire Persian army? Well, gee, maybe the story of Ukraine might go down in history too. While the Persians eventually won the battle, the courage of the Greeks, the casualties they inflicted upon the Persians, and most importantly, the time battle consumed afforded Greeks time to consolidate their forces in order to win a decisive naval victory. This brought Greece victory in the Greco-Persian War and halted the expansion of the Persian Empire into Europe. How is it also that this upstart American colony, 13 colonies, with a ragtag group of soldiers, without sufficient supplies, and definitely divided loyalties, able to defeat the finest military force in the world at that time? I'm sure the most common folks at the time felt the effort was futile. Yet the colonists rallied behind their leaders and, after 8 long years of war, managed to defeat the British. And that's why, you know, we call the World War II veterans the greatest generation, because when they were sent to Europe, they weren't like our troops going over 6 months to a year, and then you're coming back. No, they were sent for the duration. And for the duration, you usually think of the 4 years. For some of those who were in German prisoner of war camps, they spent another 5 years in Russia, because Russia took them and imprisoned them there. And some of them weren't released until the 1960s. There have been some famous political victories that probably seemed impossible. In 1860, Abraham Lincoln was basically an unknown person on the national political scene. All his rivals in the quest for the Republican presidential nomination were better known and, generally speaking, eminently more qualified. New York Senator William B. Seward, Ohio Governor Simon B. Chase, and Edward Bates, a distinguished elder statesman from Missouri. He had, through some excellent politicking and a sense of determination, not only did Lincoln win the nomination, but the White House, when the Democrats split their votes between John Breckinridge and Stephen Douglas. And a third party candidate, John Doe. In more recent memory, the pollsters and the American populace in general gave Harry Truman no chance at all in 1948. Most were calling New York Governor Thomas Dewey the winner long before voting even commenced. Gee, it sounds like a more recent election. Did you know that Hillary Clinton had a big fireworks display all set up in the New York Harbor? She must have known something was going wrong when she canceled it 6 hours before it was supposed to commence. Sports also provides some important and improbable wins. In 1986, I know most of you aren't old enough to remember that, but I am, the New York Mets seemingly had no chance to win the World Series. Down 3-2 and behind by 5 runs in the 9th inning. The end looked near. But an error by Boston Red Sox first baseman Bill Buckner gave New York new life. They won the game in the deciding 7th game. They snatched victory from the jaws of defeat. In a reverse role in 2004, the Red Sox were down 3-0 to the New York Yankees, playing at home to close out the American League Championship. The Yankees looked like a shoo-in, but the Red Sox never gave up. Not only did they win 4 straight against the Yankees, but continued their winning ways with a 4-game sweep of the St. Louis Cardinals and their first World Series win in 86 years. The infamous curse of the Bambino had been broken. And as a New Yorker, I was very upset at that curse being broken. We will face many different challenges in our lives, tasks that seem to be impossible missions. In the journey of our working days, we will face trying situations. We may face obstacles that will not allow us to work as we want. Coercion, threat, or temptation of reward may force us to do things in a manner that we know might hurt or ill affect another. We may be required to relocate in order to stay with the company, or worse still, our job might be lost. At such times, we wonder what we will do and what the future will hold. Families experience many difficult challenges. Yesterday, I was up, gave a retreat on junior high kids who are gonna be confirmed, and there was a panel and people who were confirmed last year, so they're in high school now. And I asked the people who were in high school, are they made fun of for being Catholic in school? Every single one not only said yes, every single one of them gave examples. Making fun of Catholics is socially acceptable. Discriminating against Catholics is socially acceptable. It seems that socialism is taking over because Khrushchev said we're going to raise the socialist flag over our own country. They're not going to have to conquer us. But the Catholic Church sticks out all the time. It's a lamp upon a hill, and we must be ready to face impossible odds just to practice our faith. The bishop who ordained me to the priesthood in Ukraine got caught saying a mass. The bad news for him was he was caught. It was a crime to say an unauthorized mass. And so they didn't know he was a bishop. They arrested him and put him in prison for 13 years. And as he's doing the ordination, not in the church, had my hand over my heart. I didn't want to tell us where my American passport was. I figured if I got arrested, they'd probably just throw me out of the country. But the bishop warned us that what we were doing was a crime in the Soviet Union for 13 years. Those are the rules that Putin enforced as the KGB director. So, He says he's not that way anymore. He says he's Russian Orthodox. And we can see how good he is, hopefully, in turning the other cheek. So let us pray for peace. Sisters and brothers, today's readings, Jesus has called us to have hearts of let us affirm our faith. I believe
in the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, come out of the light, true God, true to God, begotten and made, consubstantial to our Father, and given all things to me. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, as the throne of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified with Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. And rose again from the dead, and according to the Scriptures. He has ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again for the glory of the judgment of the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Lord, and the Lord, who proceeds from Father and Son, who with the Father and the Son is the glory and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I know the fruit of the resurrection of the dead, and life for all to come. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, in today's readings, we were told that we should have hearts of goodness, and in that spirit may we present our petitions.
For our Archbishop Timothy, that he may serve us in the spirit of Jesus and teach us through the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all who are one in Christ, that they will speak with integrity and reveal the weakness in others, may we hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For peace in our world, that the tensions between Ukraine and Russia will ease so that diplomacy draws people into dialogue. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For honesty among all politicians, that they may have a spirit of service which works for the common good and the welfare of those struggling in life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For our sick and frail aged, that is all their needs, that they may be helped by caring health professionals, compassionate families, and loyal friends. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all who have died alone or in fear, that they may share the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Heavenly Father, you know that each of us gathered here and watching need for our salvation. We ask you to look into our hearts and give us those perfect gifts from above. We ask this for Christ.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, become for us the bread of life. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, and become our spiritual drink. Wash away my iniquities and cleanse me of my sins. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good
O God, who provides gifts to be offered to your name and counts our obligations as signs of our desire to serve you with devotion, we ask of your mercy that what you grant as a source of merit may also help us to attain merit's reward through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just to give you thanks and raise to you a hymn of glory and praise, O Lord, Father of infinite goodness. For by the word of your Son's gospel, you have brought together one church from every people, tongue, and nation. And having filled her with life by the power of your Spirit, you never cease through her to gather the whole human race into one. Manifesting the covenant of your love, she dispenses without ceasing the blessed hope of your kingdom, and shines as bright as the sun of your faithfulness, which in Christ Jesus our Lord you promised would last for eternity. And so with all the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, while all the church as one voice we acclaim. So now for us, he opens scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask you to send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which we poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. And whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again. And we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ, which has been handed on to us. And grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may now be counted, and until the day of eternity, among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Lord, renew your church, which is here in Prairie Point, by the light of the gospel. Strengthen the bond of unity between the faithful and the pastors of your people, together with Francis our Pope and Timothy our Bishop, and his assistant bishops, and the whole order of bishops, that in a world torn by strife, your people may shine forth as a prophetic sign of unity and concord. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, with Saint Martin, the soldier, and with all the saints. We shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
spirit of meaning for those who are ready to receive. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot, may I receive you sacramentally. Come and be spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Nourished by your saving gifts, we beseech your mercy, Lord, that by the same sacrament with which you feed us in this present age, you may make us partakers of life eternal. Through Christ our Lord. Please be seated. Just some announcements. The party begins on Wednesday. The party called Lent. Springtime, new life. So Friday is, they will give out ashes. The schedule here at Prairie Point is kind of flux. It will be the 12:05 Mass, and there'll be the distribution of ashes at that. I do not know when the Protestant chaplains are going to buildings, nor do I know, because I have to go to Baltimore first. So more than likely, and there will be somebody here every after 1300, 1 o'clock to distribute ashes until 4. But also, I hope Chaplain Milner goes out in the morning and catches some of his Protestant folks. I will go over after Mass to try to avoid 1 and 364, because I figure the people there can make it here.
Or not.
And so, but the staff might not be able to, so they go for it. But then I also have to do 14, the two floors, 23, the two floors, and the one floor, 19. Because those Catholics are spread all over the place. And also, for those who are able and age-wise, so that means people in 19 or 23 don't have to observe fast and abstinence. But for those who are able, fast means one big meal, two snacks. Abstinence means, and you make sure when you pick your food, not to have a fish product. Because, you know, nutrition doesn't necessarily follow what your religious beliefs are. You have to tell them. And so, you know, you can have cereal and eggs. Especially that little thing of cereal can count as a snack. And for breakfast, you can have no pork, no chicken, no beef, and especially no mystery meat. You know what I'm talking about. They say it's something, but you look at it and you say, I don't know where that came from. And so, is it, buddy, have any questions about that?
Negative.
Okay, speaking for the rest of you. Okay, that's that. And I asked for some help taking this green thing down and putting up the foible one. Because we're not using purple, we're using violet, and get the church ready. And I will see two people, one at a time, and they know who they are. They're people who failed their test of humanity, and I'm trying to make them human again. If you believe that, I've got a beautiful preacher in New York to sell you. But I'll meet them at the table in the back one at a time. Okay, please stand. And now you know what we call Catholic calisthenics. The Lord be with you. The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God.
And I thank you all for being here.